the rewarding qualities of the food have a massive, massive impact. And again, that's what's kind of embedded in that attentional bias kind of literature and the theory. This kind of incentive salience, the biological impact that these foods have. You know, they're substances, essentially. They are addictive substances, sugary foods. So the same processes are going on in the brain as other kind of substances that are used for abuse.
Hi, I'm Naomi Murphy, and this is the Locked Up Living podcast, where we talk with a wide range of people about harsh aspects of institutional life.
We also explore some of the ways to overcome them and to grow and develop. I'm David Jones.
So join us every Wednesday morning, 6 o'clock UK time, for a fresh podcast.
So today you hear from Dr. Joe Davies, chartered psychologist and lecturer in applied psychology at Cardiff Metropolitan University. Joe's research primarily explores the causes and consequences of obesity within secure psychiatric inpatient services. Following his PhD, Joe worked for the National Collaborative Commissioning Unit of NHS Wales on Welsh Government commissioned projects aimed at improving care for secure inpatients, and subsequently published the National Review of Secure Inpatient Services, Making Days Count. Really pleased you could join us today, Joe. Welcome.
Thank you, and I'm chuffed to be here.
Hi, Joe. I'm David. Thanks very much for coming along today. So perhaps we could begin by you telling us a bit about yourself, how you got involved with studying obesity and psychiatric populations. Why did you become interested in this field?
Sure. Yeah. No. It's not particularly a whirlwind tale, but I've always kind of wanted to work with clinical populations, particularly people who have serious mental illness, since kind of school times, really. So I did a degree in psychology, naturally, psychology and counselling studies. And then wanted to kind of go into forensics. Unfortunately, couldn't do a master's in forensic psychology. I say many reasons. It was mainly financial. The other alternative was a master's in health psychology, which I didn't know an awful lot about, and I thought that was kind of a really interesting kind of area, kind of looking into it a bit more. So I did a MSc in health psychology in Cardiff Met, and really wanted to get into clinical work following the master's, but really, really difficult naturally to find kind of applied assistant psychologist posts. Obviously, they're incredibly competitive. So was kind of thinking about other options, and a PhD was kind of one of those options. Applied for a few, but I wasn't particularly passionate about any of the projects that came up. But colleagues in Cardiff Met approached me with a PhD project that also offered some really good clinical experience, working with secure inpatients, exploring obesity in that particular population. So I bit the hand off, essentially. Kind of the motivation mainly was to work with those patients whilst kind of exploring a really interesting topic, but it kind of then grew into much more of a passion project, actually working with those patients and seeing the kind of environment they're in and how that kind of impacts both their mental health and obviously their physical health. It just became much more of a passion project as opposed to a kind of a experience finding mission, essentially. So yeah, I did the PhD, and I've kind of developed this, I like to call it a healthy obsession with this issue, and trying to kind of tackle this issue and understand this issue. So been trying to continue it as much as possible since kind of finishing my PhD, really.
Thank you. That's very clear. So Naomi and I both worked in forensic health and in prison settings. And when I worked in forensic health, there used to be this rather glib and now outdated saying that go to prison to get fit, go to hospital to get fat. Do you think there's any evidence for that? What kind of data do you have?
With regards to, I don't know much about the prison population. Obviously, this is such a massively complex issue that a 4-year PhD in one specific population, secure inpatient services, wasn't enough. So I don't know much about the prison population, although I am looking to kind of conduct some comparison studies in the future. With regards to the kind of issue of being fat in secure care, that is, you know, it is a significant issue. In Wales, the average, or for Welsh patients, the average BMI is 36 kilograms per meter squared, which is in the obesity class 2 range. And you know, that's just Wales. This is a global problem as well. They're having similar issues in New Zealand, Australia, North America, other parts of Europe. I think there's quite a big range of kind of obesity prevalence, but it ranges around 30 to 80% of secure inpatient services. In the UK, I think it's closer to that 80%. Australia and New Zealand are doing some excellent work at trying to tackle the problem. So theirs are a little lower. But yeah, it's a huge issue. And it's the kind of most stark and striking thing is that patients can be admitted to secure care, kind of overweight or obese, but there's still that drastic kind of spike increase in weight gain in the initial stages of treatment. So it's not just, you know, they're a population that are already kind of overweight and obese. This secure environment is having something to do with that weight gain, which is, again, one of the reasons why the PhD was, the PhD I did was conducted and that kind of thing. So yeah, a real issue, and it's definitely that statement kind of rings true.
Thank you. Of course, I think there's always been a kind of thought or a perception among staff and others that weight gain is a consequence of psychotropic, particularly antipsychotic medication. Is that true?
I think it's a yes and no. So of course there's lots of excellent research that's kind of shown how certain antipsychotics, particularly those atypical kind of stronger, ultimately more effective antipsychotics, olanzapine and clozapine to name two, have a high risk of weight gain upon treatment. Lecht et al, I'm not sure if I pronounced that correctly, have published a few studies, and one very recently actually that I've shown that olanzapine in particular is a very high risk for weight gain. It's kind of a fight between clozapine and olanzapine, which one is the most risky, but they do certainly have an impact on patient weight. However, I've just published a study recently that essentially showed that in the first 12 weeks of treatment, the risk associated with antipsychotics wasn't a predictor of weight gain, despite patients gaining significant amounts of weight. So whilst it does have some sort of impact for these patients in particular, it seems to be something else. There's a big question mark around what that something else is, essentially. So yeah, antipsychotics definitely have their part to play, but it's not the be all and end all. There is something else having a big impact.
But of course, we'd like to know what the something else is. do you think there are psychological factors that come into play?
I think there's a few. Again, I think it's a really complex issue. But I think there are some particular psychological factors that seem to be coming out in the literature. And again, that I'm trying to explore more in my very early career. One in particular, one which I find pretty interesting, is this idea around cognitive processes related to attention. So there's this concept called attentional bias, where somebody will pay greater amount of attention to an object or stimulus that is salient, so more meaningful to them. This kind of concept was mainly based in the threat literature, but this has now moved on to kind of more the substance and food-based literature as well. My director of studies, my PhD, actually did her PhD on this very kind of concept, attentional bias and weight gain. And essentially what you find in many studies is that if you have the motivation to consume a substance, and the substance is salient and available, you're more likely to consume that substance. And you're more likely to consume that substance to excess and have a greater BMI. So we did a study in the PhD that essentially tested this kind of concept. It's very difficult to do because it requires patients to sit at a computer and complete computer-based tasks. Sometimes it requires eye tracking software, so quite invasive. So basically in this study, we essentially found that even though patients had been fed, they will attend to food stimulus the same amount as a person who is fasted or who is hungry, which says something about their kind of appetite. Despite being fed and full, they still look at food. They still find it a salient stimulus. So that's one kind of psychological fact that's not really been explored in this population, which I would like to kind of explore further. Another core one is kind of disinhibited eating, kind of the role of disinhibition, which is common among people who are being treated in secure care. Again, big predictive factor of binge eating is kind of disinhibition. But also emotional eating is another big one, and kind of comfort eating. And the thing I'm really interested in at the moment and really excited to look into more is this kind of concept of experiential avoidance. The kind of the fight between trauma, particularly childhood trauma, emotional eating, and experiential avoidance. So basically with that, we essentially have somebody who has experienced a traumatic event in their early life, and as a result, feel very difficult and negative things, or think very difficult and negative things. And so to get away from those thoughts and feelings, they engage in behaviors, what we call under aversive control. And they are often kind of health harming. So substance abuse, self-harm, but also binge eating as well. Now, there's no studies that have looked at that in this particular population, but something I'm hopefully going to be looking to in the future is really exciting.
So you're sort of suggesting, because you almost lost me there, Joe, but you're sort of suggesting there's a complex interaction between a number of different factors. And I think you mentioned four, as far as I can recall. I was thinking, because the first one you mentioned, did you term it attentional?
Attentional bias, yeah.
Bias, yeah. Mm. So to put it in crude terms, does that mean something like, if I've got a very keen interest in Battenberg cake, which I do have, if I store 10 of them for a rainy day, I'm going to eat them all on day two, sort of thing? Is that, I'm more likely to eat them all on day two?
No, it does have something to do again with your propensity to consume more food than you need, or kind of this kind of overeat, I suppose is the term. But say if you have kind of higher levels of disinhibition, kind of just general disinhibition, it may be that you eat more cake, more Battenberg on that second rainy day than somebody who has lower levels of disinhibition. But like you said it perfectly, it's a complex interplay between those things. But we don't know for sure. Again, this is something that we need to kind of look into a lot more, I think.
And I suppose also in that, there's something about the kinds of food that people overeat on. Nobody overeats lettuce, do they? it is Battenberg cake or crisps or things that are less healthy. And I suppose I'm just reading that Ultra Processed People at the moment, which is fascinating in terms of how the foodstuffs we're eating might not be proper foodstuff, so causing problems for our bodies. But then also, if we're eating lots of sugary food or things that reinforce us to keep eating, I'm not sure that it's always about appetite, is it? But what else is going on?
The rewarding qualities of the food have a massive, massive impact. And again, that's what's kind of embedded in that attentional bias kind of literature and the theory. This kind of incentive salience, the biological impact that these foods have You know, they're substances, essentially. They are addictive substances, sugary foods. So the same processes are going on in the brain as other kind of substances that are used for abuse.
And do you think, you know, you referred to kind of like the getting into unpicking the relationship between trauma and obesity. I was just thinking that kind of when you've got a history of trauma, people often end up spending a lot of mental energy thinking about their trauma, you know, feeling emotionally activated during the course of the day. And I guess if you've already got a bit of a weight problem and you're wanting to lose weight, it requires you to be quite mindful for quite a lot of the day. And have you got the mental, you know, is there any work around kind of like the cognitive load of trying to eat healthy when you perhaps have got this backdrop of trauma at the same time?
I'm not sure of any work, but that's a really good point. It's not something I've thought of, but that's yeah, I think, again, when I was kind of making that link between trauma and experiential avoidance and emotional eating, that's just the link. I think what you're talking about there is kind of the underlying mechanism at play. I think that's really interesting. Yeah, good point.
I think certainly the other thing that I think, I mean, it's probably just anecdotal, but I don't know if this is your experience as well, David, but quite often I think with overweight patients in hospitals or prisons, if when people have got a history of trauma, they often talk about overeating as a way of disguising their bodies, as a way of protecting themselves from, you know, in the same way that someone might not shower. And I don't know if you've happened across that in your research at all.
Well, the I'm not sure if you've heard of the kind of seminal ACE study by Felitti in the late 90s. Mm-hmm. Well, obviously that study was based around Felitti, who was a clinician in an obesity clinic. Mm-hmm. And he found that those that were doing the best ended up relapsing or leaving the clinic much earlier. Mm-hmm. And I think he looked into it a lot more and found that actually, well, at least possibly that it was, they felt they had no kind of self-defense mechanism in a way. There's also some other research by Pack, you know, I think it was 2008 the paper was published, and there was a qualitative study, and essentially the participants were saying that they wanted to gain weight to they felt it would make them more unappealing to their kind of their abuser. Mm-hmm. And others said it was kind of protection and that kind of thing. So I think there's weight behind that theory for sure, I think.
Yeah, it's fascinating stuff. But I think you've also looked at the role that environment might play. And are the environments that we're treating patients in obesogenic, I think was the word that you used?
Mm. Yeah, sure. Yes, we recently published a study. It was in August last year. So, it was a qualitative study interviewing staff members about why they thought patients in the service were gaining weight. Mm-hmm. And why they might have been obese. And kind of the central kind of theme that came from that was the environment itself is obesogenic. Patients are highly restricted. They are admitted in many cases under restriction orders. They might be some time before they're allowed to leave the clinic or attend the gym and that kind of stuff. So there's certain restrictions that mean that, you know, patients can't just engage in physical activity when they feel motivated to, which is often fairly limited given their kind of their circumstances. So I think and that's not to bash the secure setting. I mean, the secure setting is a fantastic place for people to have their mental illness treated, to learn skills they might not have learned prior to their admission. Interpersonal skills, building relationships and that kind of thing. But there is something about the environment that does have an impact on their physical health. And I'm not sure the services are kind of really aware of that. The kind of more higher up people who kind of run these services and stuff. I'm not sure they're totally aware of the impact that the setting has, which they should, in my opinion.
And what are the health implications of obesity for psychiatric patients?
I think there's two kind of key implications. There's the physical health and the mental health. So I think with the physical health, obviously, people with serious mental illness, the majority of people in secure settings have a severe mental illness. Many have comorbid physical health issues, cardiovascular disease, respiratory disease, type 2 diabetes, and other kind of obesity-related diseases, which ultimately is a massive contributor to this, you know, what we know about this very reduced life expectancy. You know, it's 15 years lower than the general population. And up to a third of these deaths, or might even be two thirds, is related to these physical health or physical illnesses, comorbid physical illnesses. So there's massive physical health implications. But again, if you think about the mental health implications as well, these people want to be, or they're being treated for their mental illness. But obesity can have massive implications for self-esteem, self-worth. People who are obese are more self-stigmatizing. People who have mental illnesses are more self-stigmatizing. So is there like a, you know, a dual stigma effect happening there? And ultimately, you know, it serves to have an impact on their recovery. You know, they don't feel good about themselves. How are they expected to get better in this environment if they don't feel they're worth much? Yeah. Mm. So yeah, two key issues there: physical health and mental health.
You referred to stigma there, and there is kind of like a sense of, you know, one of the things I liked about in that ultra-processed book actually was the person who wrote it justifies talking about obesity as a disease because of the shame that's there around obesity, that there's an assumption that if people are overweight, that it's all their own fault, they're just too greedy. And I wondered, you know, before we were interviewing you, I was thinking, you know, why hasn't it been an area that's been considered worthy of attention before? Because it is so, I mean, you're saying kind of like potentially 80% of the patient population is overweight. You know, why hasn't it been considered interest-worthy previously? And is that a reflection of the stigma around obesity, or is something else going on?
It's difficult to know. I think, I mean, so there are kind of public health documentation that have been published that have aimed to improve food provision in secure settings, but service evaluations of those are very rarely conducted. I don't know of any that have been conducted really. And again, and this is not the only evidence I have for this, is the conversations I've had with staff members, and that study we published. But there's an element of, let's focus on the psychiatric stuff because this is a psychiatric based environment. You know, mental health nurses don't feel often it's within their remit to deal with physical health, the physical health problems of their patients, because they're not general nurses, they are mental health nurses. Psychologists sometimes aren't, they're not trained in health psychology. You know, they're clinical psychologists. They're there to improve all manner of things, and often some psychologists will kind of implement general kind of healthier behavior change stuff, but not always. And it's understandable though, because like, again, a mental health nurse trains to be a mental health nurse, not a general nurse. A psychiatrist is trained to be a psychiatrist, not a GP. So I think there's just a lack of kind of integrated physical health care. It's more, this is a psychiatric environment, let's improve their mental illness and reduce their risk, because that's what our job is.
That's good. Thanks, Joe. And as we're talking to you, I'm reminded of it. We had a conversation with Leslie Sobel and Roy Waterman, where they were speaking about food and allowing, finding ways to make it possible for prisoners in American jails to grow their own food and make meals that were nutritious. And I suppose that really exposed this sense of a lack of really thinking through what the consequences are of a poor diet, that actually, you know, maybe if we paid more attention to what people were ingesting and tried to work more actively to promote healthier behavior, you know, would we see less aggression, less, you know, improvements in mental well-being generally? And I know you probably don't have the answer to that, but I wonder if you do have thoughts about the kind of foods that we make accessible to, certainly in prisons, obviously people can cook, but they're cooking on a very limited budget, and the foodstuffs are more expensive to buy for them to buy than it would be for us to go to the supermarket. So I just wondered if you have had any thoughts on the food availability.
Oh, for sure. I'm not sure. I know there is, and I don't know it enough to recite any real knowledge around it, but I know there is some literature around the type of food that you eat and how that can increase violence and that kind of stuff. So I was actually at a conference last week in Australia, and one of the presenters on my kind of, I was presenting on physical health, and one of the presenters in that session actually looked at or kind of was promoting blood lipid levels as a marker of violence risk. So that was really interesting, but I don't know the literature enough to kind of have any real knowledge around it. In terms of the actual kind of availability and stuff of food, I think it's really interesting the way that and important the way that food is provided, not just the food that they have, but the way it's provided. So in many NHS-based services, patients will get lunch and they'll get dinner provided for them. They'll get lunch around midday and they'll get dinner around 5 o'clock. What happens from 5 until the morning or lunchtime, you know, the staff go home, they can't go out of the service necessarily. What do they have to do? They're bored, you know, again, many of them aren't feeling particularly great. The best thing they can do is to feel good, is to ingest those high reward foods, which I think is a really important thing that needs to be addressed. The other thing is, which I found really stark and we found in that paper, is that patients will know what day of the week it is based on what is for dinner, which I think is tragic. Again, there's public health documentation that's tried to improve the quality and the taste of foods for patients, but it's obviously not enough, I think. So it has a massive, massive impact, I think.
It reminds me when I worked at the John Howard Centre, and the patients there would have their three meals a day, plus a bit extra. But then in the evening, they'd be able to order in a pizza or fried chicken or something.
The issue is we don't want to restrict them anymore, though, do we? This is the thing. It's such a delicate issue, because there's so many restrictions. Let's let them have something tasty and delicious. You know, let's at least give them that, you know, there's a sense of that. So it's a really difficult issue to tackle. And something that I don't envy policymakers kind of having to deal with in the future, if they do, hopefully.
Good. I'm glad you don't envy them. I don't either. But it reminds me also, because I was in hospital for a couple of days last year, first time since I had my tonsils out as a kid. And what struck me was there was a lot of food. They were always bringing around food, breakfast, lunch, tea. And it was like going back to when I, you know, lived with my mum, because the food was very similar. Sort of meat pie and mashed potato, and that, which I loved, actually. But it did make me wonder, and this will apply to psychiatric hospitals as well as general hospitals, but shouldn't there be more of an input from nutritionalists?
I think this is a really, really key problem, and something that I found working in that secure service I was working in during my PhD was the lack of input from a nutritionist. And I don't know whether that is kind of across the board. There is a little bit of data that kind of elucidates some of that, which I'll talk about in a sec. But ultimately, I never saw the nutritionist. I've tried to communicate with the nutritionist to discuss what was going on. In that national review of Welsh secure inpatients, there's data in that review that shows the amount of input from nutritionists, and it's remarkably low for a population who are, the majority are obese. To have such little communication with a nutritionist, a physical health professional, of any kind, is extraordinarily low. I don't know why. I'm not a nutritionist. I don't know how it works. Are they assigned to several hospitals and therefore they have lots of ground to cover? I don't know what it is, but I think it would be an amazing resource that should definitely be utilized more. I know some services have like a physical health team that includes a nutritionist, which is fantastic. But it, you know, again, this is a global problem. This is not just kind of localized to one secure service. It should be perhaps a blanket kind of provision, perhaps.
I suspect the people who get referred, like in prison, will be the people where there's a, you know, their health is really seriously compromised by their obesity, and yet we know that you know, that obesity will be impacting way before they're at that point, don't we?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Do you have any other ideas about how we could improve things? You know, do people with lived experience that you've interviewed have, could they play a bigger role in contributing to shaping policy?
I think that's would be a huge benefit. Unfortunately, I haven't. That was kind of one of the caveats to that qualitative study I published, was we didn't interview patients, which we, you know, we should have. There's a reason, you know, the reasons were ultimately because we didn't want to kind of overburden with patients, and, you know, we'd done some other research with them. But ultimately, yeah, there needs to be kind of, you know, that's the kind of next step, isn't it? It's asking the patients themselves what, you know, what is going on for you? What do you think is the issue here? What is your experience? And what do you think needs to be done to help you? I think that's vital. I think, yeah, patient involvement is absolutely vital. But also there's so many other things that need to be done as well. Again, we need to be thinking about kind of the input that, or kind of recognition from the kind of very higher up people, and how the environment is impacting patients' weight. I think I'm one of quite a few, I mean, there are a few researchers that are looking into this problem. And it is getting more traction. I mean, at that conference, there was a session specifically dedicated to physical health within forensic settings. So, you know, it's about promotion of kind of this issue, and it's not going to be for everyone. That's a given. But as long as kind of us researchers are chipping away at the issue and trying to find out more, you know, hopefully that will snowball into some sort of kind of lasting change in the future. But patient involvement, absolutely vital.
Joe, just thinking, you're obviously spending a lot of time thinking about obesity and its impact on wellness and well-being. And does that cause you to have reflections or questions about wider society and obesity and the, because, you know, obviously it is a big problem, isn't it, for the certainly the Western world?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I was driving back to Swansea, where I'm from Cardiff, very recently, and I drove past the new fancy private hospital that they've created, and next, or just past that new fancy kind of health center, there was a gigantic billboard of McDonald's, of the most kind of wonderful looking burger. No doubts. Well, I think it's actually had a Burger King of the day that was 1200 calories. So, I mean, there's just such a confusing society that we live in, right? It's just like, I don't know much about kind of the philosophy around consumerism and kind of capitalism and that kind of stuff, but I assume it has that, you know, it has a big part to play. And it's almost like, for me especially, it's kind of like the more I demonize these kind of, I mean, we shouldn't really be demonizing people for having high calorie foods. We should be treating ourselves. You should be allowed to have whatever food we want, really. It's just kind of recognizing the impact that too much of this kind of high calorie, very tasty, rewarding food can have on your body. And if you are in a position where you struggle really, really, you know, a lot to inhibit your consumption of these foods, then we need to help as much as we can, you know? Yeah, it's a nightmare because I have to kind of count calories and stuff all the time, which gets gets really frustrating. And then often I'll just have, you know, a whole thing of Ben and Jerry's. Yeah, you know, and that's difficult for me, who's very privileged, who, you know, lives at home and can do whatever I want very freely. Where we have people who are in secure care that, you know, get a lot from eating very delicious foods that are high calories.
And so just coming to the end, Joe, how do you keep yourself psychologically healthy and nourished while studying, you know, something that actually has the capacity to really be quite painful part of life for people?
I get very into things. I'm very obsessive with things, and I like to call them healthy obsessions. I love to exercise. It seems kind of cliche, but I do love to exercise. I like to grapple. So not very recently, but I generally practice Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, which I find incredibly mentally stimulating, but also being able to practice kind of mindfulness in those spaces are really, really important for me. Letting off steam is obviously just a really big part of it. And also trying my best to do absolutely no work when I can, but I am a bit of a workaholic, so that's a big struggle. But staying active is kind of the big thing.
Thank you very much. That's great.
Thanks a lot, Joe. I'm still remembering that statistic you gave us that such patients have a loss of 15 years in life expectancy. That's a really powerful statement. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.